Thank you very much. So, let me give you this back. That was a great start. It was exactly what we wanted to do here, which was to talk about problems and solutions and do so in a way that was practical, and we did not get hung up in the usual political debates. That's our focus for today. We're going to do it in a variety of ways and as interactively as we possibly can. We're going to get everybody here around this table involved, but periodically we'd also like to get all of you in this room involved. And the way that we're going to do that is with these little blue polling devices that all of you have and you should have found on your seats. And we're just going to do this a couple times to get a flavor and to give everybody on the panel a sense of what the room is thinking on a variety of issues. And we're going to start out with just four simple questions, very basic to get you used to this, and then I'm going to start turning to the panel for their comments and thoughts on all of this. And so if you pick up the device, it's simple. You just hit the number that corresponds to the button. If we could go to the first question, please. We'll switch over and you'll see it on these monitors. And it'll say here, on a scale of 1 to 5, how important is infrastructure as a national priority? You know, you can rate it against other top priorities, national security and so forth, or it's a marginal priority, we shouldn't do it. Now, you're all at an infrastructure conference. I kind of know how this is going to go. It's more to get you used to the questions. But let's see, pick 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, depending on where you want to be on this thing. And there's a little countdown clock, which should go counting down immediately as soon as I finish reading the question. And then 1 second later, we get the answer. And so you see here, not surprisingly, that 83% of you rate it as a top priority. Somebody rated it as a marginal priority. And the exit is just here. You're under no obligation to remain in the room. Let's go to the next of the questions. What's the top reason that we should prioritize infrastructure investment? Job creation, boosting competitiveness, improvement of quality of life, safety, or other? Now, if you say other, I'm going to ask you what you mean, but please don't mean all of the above, okay? I get it. You could pick any of these things. Pick the one you think is top. Boosting American competitiveness is 60% of you say, and then the 25% say quality of life. Who said other? Why did you say other?
I think it's productivity.
When you're around the table here, if you hit the button before you speak, it'll make it easier.
I think the goal is productivity, which is different than competitiveness.
Maybe we'll go into that a little bit more in the context of the discussion. All right, the next question, two more questions, then we're going to get into the discussion. How do you rate the state of U.S. infrastructure versus that of other developed nations? Pick a nation that you think has good infrastructure. Are we much better, are we the same, or are we much worse? 1 through 5. And then there'll be one more question after this. And so, I mean, that says really, you know, why we're here, where you have 72% of the people saying worse or much worse. So, we, you know, who says we're much better, by the way? Somebody thinks we have much better infrastructure than other developed nations? Okay, it's the same person who wants to leave in a minute, I think. All right. There's always somebody like that in a crowd, and we'll figure out who you are sooner or later. All right, one more. What has been the biggest policy obstacle holding back infrastructure development in the U.S.? Is it permitting and licensing, regulatory hurdles? 2, shortage of sustainable financing mechanisms? 3, lack of long-term policy certainty? 4, political dysfunction? Or 5, other? Now, all of these contribute. What do you think has been the biggest one? This will just help our panelists as we go in and we start having this discussion. And so 68% of you rate political dysfunction and lack of policy certainty is next. Somebody said other. Who said other? Why did you say other?
I wanted to point out NIMBYism, not my backyardism.
NIMBYism. Okay, good. So that's this for the questions. Let's go back to the screens here. What I'd like to do, though, as we start this off, first of all, I want to lay out the ground rules of conversation. When you talk, identify yourself, hit the button. The idea is a conversation, not speechifying. So I'm going to go to you in random order. As a, you know, some of you have been asked to kick off these discussions. I will go to you first, of course. But the idea is let's converse with each other and let's make this a sort of a large brainstorming session. Let's keep the remarks fairly brief. That way we'll get back to people frequently as opposed to speechifying. But I want to frame it. And I thought the best way to frame it is Bernard has been a sort of a champion of these issues for a long time. And the first panel here is to sort of say, what's the problem? What's the challenge? How big is the challenge? How do you see the challenge? You've been involved in these things. Maybe for a minute or two, you could lay out what you think the scope of the problem we've got to wrestle with is. It's our AV infrastructure. It's a metaphor.
I didn't expect to speak this morning. However,
either apparently did the AV team. But here you go.
First of all, I want to thank you all for coming here. This is an important event for all of us. Some of us have been working on an infrastructure improvement program in this country for many years, not just for a short period of time. I have never spoken to anybody in politics who does not recognize the fact that there is an infrastructure problem in this country. I have not spoken to anybody who does not believe we ought to have a program that fixes it. And that's where the conversation stops. Politically, it is just not capable, has not been capable, of getting a program done in this country. And that's too bad. And as we continue to have a deficiency in spending for infrastructure, the deficiency continues to grow. So that every city, every town, every place in America can point to the fact that we're not spending enough money in infrastructure. But I'm using the wrong word. When I say spend, I hope that what comes out of this conference is the idea that we're talking about investment, not spending. There's something very strange about the American system of accounting, of scoring for money that is spent in the country. We include in the balance sheet, the national balance sheet, the liability side of any particular project that we have, but we don't score the investment.
Turn it up, please.
In business, and in most cities, but all businesses, you have an investment that comes as an asset on your balance sheet, and you have a liability that has to be paid off in time. The federal government does not do that. So that the American people look upon this kind of investment as an expense, when in fact, it's something that will build America. The return on it is extraordinary. We're not talking about something new. Since 1802, the Louisiana Purchase, this country has been making investments in infrastructure. Think of what the Erie Canal or the Grand Coulee Dam has done in terms of creating wealth for America, way in excess of the investment. What we're talking about here is not new. It's something we've been doing for years. Every year, in the United States, 2% of our gross national product is spent on infrastructure. Unfortunately, the requirement is about 3%. And that deficiency of 1% continues to grow, and we can't get it done. And we can't get it done because of political will. But one of the things I'd like to hear during this morning is that we're not only talking about the investment and what it does in terms of bringing the Grand Coulee Dam or the Erie Canal or the Triborough Bridge onto our balance sheet. What I'd like to see some concentration on is the job creation part of that program. America has a job deficiency, an unemployment problem that continues to grow. A program of size could help that program a lot. and infrastructure, an infrastructure program of the size that we're talking about could put about 10 million people back to work in this country, and that's a very valuable thing for us to be doing. So I'm hopeful that what we have here in our conversation is not a description of what the deficiency is, but a how-to. How can we correct the problem?
I think, by the way, I'm told, and I don't believe them, but if we hold this down, then it'll come on. So there it's on. I will turn to you, and then I'm going to turn to Senator Warner, because I know you have a vote, and you have to leave at 10.
I just want to quickly echo what Bernard said about job creation.
When I was governor in 2010, we had the stimulus funds. We got $1 billion in stimulus money from the federal government for roads and highways and bridges. The U.S. Department of Transportation says for every $1 billion spent, we create 25,000 jobs. These are well-paying jobs that pay $55,000, $60,000, $70,000, $80,000 a year, family-sustaining jobs. We decided to track that $1 billion in spending. Not only the jobs that were on the roads and on the bridges, right on the construction site, but we found out every vendor that was used to complete the job, steel for the bridge, paint for the bridge, et cetera. We contacted the vendors and asked how many people they hired to meet the demand from stimulus. After it was all said and done, we didn't produce 25,000 jobs. We produced 24,672. So imagine if America upped its spending on infrastructure by $200 billion a year, which the American Society of Civil Engineers recommends. That's over 5 million well-paying jobs.
But you were 328 jobs short.
Can I just say one thing?
Yeah.
The critical part of the infrastructure discussion in America is what the good governor here just talked about, that what we require in terms of bringing us up to a first national, international country in terms of infrastructure may cost $2 trillion or $1.5 trillion. Here's the point. An infrastructure program to the United States does not cost $2 trillion, because we're talking about a self-liquidating program. What we're talking about is the shortfall. And that shortfall is more in the nature, over a 10-year period, of maybe $100 billion, not $2 trillion. We get a $2 trillion asset that's mostly self-liquidating at a cost of $100 billion. We ought to be talking about that more often so the American people are not scared of it.
Senator, you've heard a lot. And you would know we're oriented towards solutions, so perhaps you could solve this and we can all go home.
Yes, because I work at a place where we solve things on a regular basis.
That's why you're here with us, escaping. Yeah,
I do have some specific suggestions on solutions, and I recognize that we don't need to reframe the problem. But you got to give me 2 minutes to at least give my negative view about framing the problem. I would say at the macro level, as we look at the whole political debate, if there's one takeaway I make as somebody who's fairly obsessed about the balance sheet issues, is that if there was a story that's not been written as large as it should be written, is that Grover Norquist and his view of America is winning. And I say that because I work in the only place in America where we have an $18 trillion debt, and that we have members of Congress high-fiving when our annual deficit is only $400 billion. I mention that in relationship to infrastructure because I do believe, Bernard, I think on a run rate, I would agree with you that $100 billion makes sense, but in terms of aggregate overall national debt, I think that $18 trillion number underestimates by a couple trillion the accumulated additional debt from failure to invest in infrastructure. And in the numbers we're looking at right now, We are, again, three quick factoids to give you mid-morning indigestion. One is, when interest rates go up, as they will, 100 basis point increase in interest rates will add $120 billion a year in additional debt service right off the top. That is more than we spend in infrastructure. That is more than we spend combined Department of Education and Department of Homeland Security combined. And that is, since it's debt payment, will be trump every other investment we make. So point one, we're on this non-sustainable.
You had to say Trump, right?
Yeah. And it is this ball and chain that is dragging down our ability to invest or to think grand thoughts as a nation. Second, we are on the path right now on domestic discretionary spending, where all of our, not only infrastructure, but education and research, that whole bucket, we are on a path not from the days of stimulus, but from the days of George Bush 43. If we take our 2007 numbers, we are on a path to cut that level of domestic discretionary spending in half over the next decade. We are already at an historic low on domestic discretionary spending as a percent of GDP. And we are on a path, again, just to put this in perspective, of cutting 2007 numbers in half, and that again goes to infrastructure. And to make things even more a bit grim at the outset, something again that you would not hear in any of the candidates who are talking frankly in either party, out of the 34 industrial nations in the world, the OECD nations, you know, one of the great quiz questions should have been, where do you think America ranks in terms of total revenue raised? Most people would assume we're a high tax nation. Out of the 34 OECD nations, in terms of total revenue raised as a percent of GDP, not just federal, state, local, and federal, we are 32nd out of 34. So we have the combination of the highest nominal rate, particularly on the business side, yet we are on a path that we will never raise the revenues to not only get to balance, but not even get to close to balance. So there are creative ideas and creative solutions, but we have a remarkable, remarkable revenue problem that pushes us into highway bills. This most recent one that was dealt with in the Senate, which instead of having what has been historically about a 40% increase over every six-year basis, was about a 11% increase, and frankly, I voted against it because it was the worst of robbing Peter to pay Paul in terms of, you know, using custom fees or using housing fees or other things totally unrelated to transportation or infrastructure to get things done. Now, let me quickly end with, you know, there are optimistic good news. You know, there are states all across the country, many of them led by Republicans, who've increased user fees, gas taxes. That is the most logical, rational, forward-leaning way. There does not seem to be much appetite in Congress, in many ways because of the Grover Norquist pledge, but there are states that are taking it on. Second, there is an effort, which I'm involved in, not a perfect solution set, of saying if we can't do all of tax reform, we could at least do international tax reform, and in the one-time toll charge of some of these dollars coming back, we'd at least create a fairly substantial one-time six-year bucket of money. Now, creates a greater cliff down the road, but at least it would put a bucket of dollars to work. Third, and something that I've been working on that was secret for a few weeks, but nothing stays secret in this town forever, I think there is a moment in time where I would argue it is in America's long-term economic interest, security interest, and even environmental interest for us to go ahead and get rid of the ban on export of American oil. That would increase American domestic production about 20-25%, add hundreds of thousands of jobs. I think there is a deal there that would say adding a federal severance tax, and I won't get into all the complexity of it right now, but adding a severance tax as part of the trade to lift the ban on export of oil could give us on the plan. I've got a $300 billion revenue stream once it's fully phased in that could actually give us the kind of boost of investment and would extract, at least from a political standpoint, a little bit of a pain from both sides that might actually give us a path to a solution set.
Okay, I'm going to continue the discussion here, but I want to just take advantage of the fact that you're here for a second and address one issue that's specifically come up, and that is this isn't spending, it's investing. And yet we, unlike businesses and countries around the world, insist on treating it as spending and treating the two things as the same. What's the likelihood that can ever change in the context of the system you're dealing with?
I think it will be hard within the scoring context. If we could wave, if Eddie Rendell and I could get together and wave the magic wand on
that's
scoring,
what we're hoping for here.
You know,
this morning.
That we would one, put the infrastructure debt or deficit into the national debt or deficit, that we would think about a capital budget separate from an operating budget. And one, if we could do that, what we could also take on, and something that Ed and I have worked on for some time, where there is, I also want to leave you with some hope, and I think Heidi is going to speak at the end of this panel, but the infrastructure bank that had been the president and Senator Kerry had been such advocates of, in a slightly new model, it is no longer an infrastructure bank, because as we all know with things like the Export-Import Bank, if you call something a bank, it is forbidden. It has been reworked and remade into an infrastructure financing authority, not a bank. It would have the same principles. It would have a slightly more conservative, no first dollar loss on the public, but a proposal that in the past had no more than two Republican co-sponsors. I have six Republican co-sponsors on a so-called Bridge Act, 6 D's, 6 R's. I've got another half dozen Republicans who actually want to do this infrastructure financing authority because they realize we are the only nation in the world. We have TIFIA, which is a great initiative, but we have no national infrastructure tool that can provide the long-term financing and the expertise, frankly, to go against Wall Street that is needed. And I want to leave on an optimistic note. I do think, whether it is a end of the year deal or others, and a international tax reform deal or others, there is a much, much higher probability that an infrastructure financing tool, which is, again, moving us away from thinking about this as an expenditure and more as an investment, will be part of the mix.
Only in Washington does deleting the word bank make a commonsensical idea possible. And when we get it down to a really good acronym, it may actually become reality. I'm going to go to Jeff Madrick, and then I'm going to go to Carl. I'm going to hand these around here as we go, so you know, just because I don't trust the rest of this system. Jeff, based on what you've heard, what are you thinking right now?
Thanks.
Go ahead. Yeah. No, I think it's on.
Okay. Thanks for inviting me. We are embattled by an austerity attitude in America. We're really in a prison of austerity, and it's very hard to get out of that. But I think also, while Americans want infrastructure at a local level, and a lot of surveys talk about it, and a lot of people want safe, reliable infrastructure that reduces pollution and creates good communities, I don't think as yet they fully understand that it can also increase productivity, which is the heart of the matter. Because productivity is the source of economic growth and ultimately the source of long-term job growth. That is not always in the discussion. It tends to be more in the discussion when we're talking about short-term issues. So I do think Washington has a teaching lesson, and I come from New York, so I'll be full of naive comments, but Washington has a teaching lesson to the rest of the nation, infrastructure investment can reduce productivity and increase all kinds of jobs, not just construction and manufacturing jobs in the local community. That's a big teaching lesson to do. I think it comes from the president and some high up leaders. I think at the state level, it should come from state officials, but I don't think it's fully understood. Now, I see some bits of optimism around the country. Let me point out one that I think many of you might be skeptical of, our Second Avenue subway in New York City. Now, most New York City people hate this darn thing because you can't get around on Second Avenue. But when that is completed, they're going to be happy as a lark. That's my optimistic prediction. Call me a fool when it is completed. There's another plan in New York City to connect the 34th Street Penn Station to the 42nd Street Grand Central Station. Another extraordinary infrastructure project if it gets done. Both of these will have enormous impact on productivity in terms of getting people to work on time, in terms of attracting business, and probably in terms of productivity across the country. Now, how do we talk about that in terms of productivity nationwide? Well, Los Angeles has an unusual metro system. Some people are naysayers about that, but I'm pretty optimistic about that. Once it gets down to the train to the beach and train to Wilshire and spreads around. Again, another opportunity to increase productivity. Maybe it's the small projects that build the big idea. I have to very much, just let me say one thing. We do have an infrastructure bank, as Rahm Emanuel pointed out. It is TIFIA. It can be expanded by the government. It's possible the next president can do this on taking office. It may not need congressional support. That, to me, is a big deal, expanding TIFIA right away. There are a couple of other things very quickly, because I may not get back to this.
No, well, we'll get back to you, so just keep it brief.
Okay, quickly. We really need some kind of task force in America to make this issue clear. Big time task force with big time people telling us how productivity works, how infrastructure works, and trying to determine what kinds of projects we need that'll make it work best.
Good. We will come back to you. I'm going to come to you next. So, Carl, you've been observing this. You've also been observing Washington. I think it'll just go on when you speak for a long time. We're looking here for signs of optimism, progress, solutions. What are you seeing?
Keep talking and maybe it'll work.
Yeah.
I want to approach this from a little different point of practicality that we've been aspiring to here and say, hi, fellow Republicans. Because, first of all, Dwight Eisenhower was a Republican, Teddy Roosevelt was a Republican, and somehow Republicans have to be involved in the solution to this problem, particularly in this town. To go to the idea of a major conference, a major initiative that was just mentioned, you've got to include Republicans. Otherwise, nothing is going to happen in terms of what ought to be a fact-based debate. And as we know in this town, I was born up the street. My mother was born up the street. The real difference in Washington today is you can't have a fact-based debate. And it's really true on this particular issue. So it's a journalistic problem as I see it partly, and it's a problem of age. The cohort that is not here are young people, really young people. And
I resent that remark.
That's okay. My generation, Bernard's generation, people up here, we've done great at civil rights, we've done great at civil liberties, all kinds of things in this country, private initiatives, but we have left young people with a horrible legacy. And it's in this area, and unless young people become involved in what we're discussing today, I don't think we're going to solve the problem of the future, including on panels like this, that there's a journalistic and a perception and a priority problem that also has to involve young people. And the journalistic priority of infrastructure is somewhere down near the bottom if you were to press on one of these things. My guess is you'd come up with about 3% or something as a journalistic priority and as a story. That's got to change. It has to become part of our agenda. How does that happen? I come back to the notion of we need to redefine the agenda, the political agenda, through the journalistic agenda, and through young people's agenda. Somehow, a new way has to be found to look at this triangle that I've just described. Because if we continue to go the path that we're on with lack, we all seem to agree here, I think, on the lack of investment, on the consequences of the lack of investment, on where we are in regard to the rest of the world on this. We are so great. Look around this town. Look at the gentrification of this town since I grew up here. It's astonishing. The real gentrification of this country that needs to take place is in infrastructure. And it becomes available to all our people. How can we make that a priority? We're not going to be able to do it until we bring in the whole political system. I defer to Senator Warner on this and others, but I think it involves young people. And I'd like to hear other people on this question of how do we get those involved who aren't. I'm happy to address the journalistic question, which is a really vexing one, because this is not a quote, you know, look at what the priorities in our media are today. It is very hard to spend a half an hour on Morning Joe, and that's the best of the broadcast, perhaps, in terms of inside Washington, talking about infrastructure. How do we get infrastructure into the media priorities?
Okay. Well, that's a question. By the way, I've watched Governor Rendell do about a half an hour on Morning Joe on infrastructure pretty well. But
Senator.
John Stewart's
a good example. Since I've got to run off in a moment to finish fixing America.
We all thank you for that, Senator.
Let me pose two areas where I think there is an enormous opportunity. And I think Carl is right. I mean, one of the things that has taken place without much media fanfare is the fact that the millennials now have bumped my age cohort, the baby boomers, off the stage. They are 83 million strong. They will, within a few years, be the majority of the workforce. And quite honestly, they don't have a lot of faith in our political system at all. And frankly, most politicians don't know how to relate or talk to them. Two issues that I have spent some time on that I think indirectly might give us a slightly different way of thinking about infrastructure with younger people that just don't come up with my sobering list of statistics. One, there is a fundamental transformation going on in the nature of work. The idea that people are going to go out and work, as my dad did, for the same firm for 40 years, just is not coming to pass. Matter of fact, if you go from that generation to my generation, where we might have moved around three or four times, you ask a millennial now, you don't ask them where do they work, you ask them what are they working on. And there is I had the CEO of Airbnb, Brian Chesky, in yesterday. He gives a riff that may not be fully true, but he's saying the whole notion of American success, which is own a house, own two cars, maybe you get a little house on the lake, has been changed to where people now want to collect experiences, share items, live in a different kind of framework, and the number of young people that I know who are married living in group houses is a dramatic change. The fact that if everyone is going to go forward with Uber and Lyft and Sidecar and all of these abilities to monetize your time, your car, your apartment in ways never happened before has huge implications for infrastructure, for example. If we all don't have to own our own car, and we're going to share these in a different way, number one. Number two, I think there is, and I think you're seeing some of this frustration play out in both, say, Bernie's campaign on our side and some of the cartoon characters on the other side, you know, I say this as a proud capitalist, but the current form of American capitalism, with its enormous focus on short-termism, is not working. You know, a capitalism that is driven by quarterly profits only, that has a very narrow, somehow without any actual legal change, the fiduciary duty notion of the 60s and 70s that said you have an obligation to, yes, your shareholders, but also, as Damon make mention many times, your community, your workers, and others, has a bit disappeared. The good news is there's a whole lot of folks, particularly amongst the millennials, who reject that notion. So there are efforts popping up all over the country, Kip Tyndall at Container Store, of an idea called conscientious capitalism. There's an effort out of New York called the B Corp movement, the Benefit Corp movement, that's now in 31 states. You've got folks like Larry Fink and Paul Tudor Jones who are rethinking the whole notion of fiduciary duty in terms of investing. There may be a chance when our political system, which has kind of defaulted into either government redistribution or this notional trust in the unfettered hand of capitalism as the only two options that work, neither one of those work in a society where, frankly, the old model that says you've got shortage of capital and abundance of labor has actually been turned on its head. We got plenty of capital, but shortage of qualified labor. And are there ways to think about investment cycles, investment forms, potentially even new corporate forms, that would reward companies for actually paying and training workers in a different way? We get a new frame of a political debate. I think you may be able to get a whole host of young people involved. It can't be Democrat, Republican. It can't be, for example, on the on-demand economy, saying you're either a W-2 or a 1099. We have a chance to make some of these issues future past rather than left right, and I think that would completely change the nature of who's sitting at this table and might actually bring some of the exciting new ideas rather than just the depressing statistics on numbers that I laid out earlier.
Okay, that's
one quick thing there.
Sure, go ahead.
I'll be done with my remarks on this aspect because I think where we're going here is where I hoped we would, at least in this little section. And the senator has come up with some practical notions. But somewhere in here, the same way that the new economy, the tech economy, the Uber economy, infrastructure can be made sexy. Really. And that is going to be part of how we do this. This is about the future of the country. It's about the young people's lives we're talking about. The priority, as I see it in practical terms, is to frame this issue the same way tech has been framed, the same way the space race was contained, was framed in another generation, that we've got to make it a priority of what's on our mind in our national debate, in our media diet. The terms of engagement have to be changed all around, and particularly coming back to young people in their forums. In their forums in school, in their forums in social media, in forums that we don't even know about in this room. So I'm back to, you've got it. This can't be a left-right debate. It can't be part of the cultural warfare that has made this town just a disaster.
Okay.
And it is.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think also another dimension of this point, which is key to keep in mind as we go through this today, is we're building infrastructure, investing in infrastructure for the long term. That means that we need to think about what the technologies and the modalities of that long term are going to be. If you're living in a world of autonomous vehicles, the infrastructure is different. If you're living in a world of different kinds of mobile money and different kind of payment mechanisms. Perhaps the revenue generation mechanisms will also be different. And I think getting out of the box and following in the vein of what Senator Warner was saying is very important in the search for solutions. I'm going to Ed Luce in a second. David, you wanted to make a brief comment on behalf of millennials? Was that the...
Thank you, David. Sure, as our token millennial, I'll just throw a few thoughts in the ring, which is that I think it's incumbent on millennials to really advocate for long-termism, like Senator Warner was talking about, to really advocate for intergenerational questions. And so I'll put on the table that I think a fundamental player that hasn't come up in discussion so far, and I hope that millennials will ask for this to be addressed, is the very foundation of our capitalist system, custodians of intergenerational wealth, which are long-term asset owners, pensions, insurance, family offices, endowments. To me, these are the investors that are best suited to solve some of these questions, not only for job creation over the next decade, but also best suited to address questions like climate change, like security, like resiliency, yeah, that are going to be embedded into our infrastructure. So, and to me, the reason they're not doing it today, the reason that on average only 1% of these long-term investors allocate investments towards infrastructure, 1% of their investments are allocated to infrastructure, is because there is a principal agent problem in terms of the asset owners and the asset managers. Incentives are not aligned towards long-termism between those two. And also, because there's an inability for them to direct investly. There's not a sufficient level of professionalization within these investors. So if we start treating the custodians of intergenerational wealth and the foundation of our capitalist system like serious financial actors instead of just public employees, I think we're going to start to see different results and we're going to get the investment we need.
Okay, but clearly, I mean, again, one of the issues we come back to again and again and again in terms of seeking solutions here is that it's got to be public-private, and you're not going to, without the right kind of incentives and the right kind of action from the government, get there. I'll come to you in a moment, Damon. I want to go to Ed here. You can be a honorary millennial if you like. Yeah, Generation X. But you view this from another perspective. You're the America's columnist for the FT, and you view it in a global context, and I think it's a kind of a useful view to have as we're in this first framing session here.
Yeah, well, when you asked the question about whether American infrastructure was better or worse than other countries and people said worse, I presume they weren't thinking of Britain, so I'm not here as an expert on how to do it. I've got a lighthearted point and a serious point. The lighthearted point is about whether infrastructure is unsexy, as Carl mentioned. Well, my compatriot, John Oliver, did a whole show on infrastructure. For those who watch it, the immortal line, "I'm the best dam inspector in the country," with obvious play on the word dam. And that was one of his highest rated shows ever. I think the problem is with the word infrastructure. Everybody in this country can get riled up, understandably, if you talk to them about traffic jams. It can ruin political presidential careers, if you look at Chris Christie. If you look at the politics of Governor Walker in Wisconsin, and the money he put into the Marquette interchange, the notorious Marquette interchange outside Milwaukee, then you see that it can have an impact at the state and national presidential level. So talk to people about internet speeds and how often their Netflix freezes up. This is sexy. It's just the word, that horrible Latinate, multisyllabic word, infrastructure. So I think it's just a question of vocabulary. My serious point is this. I agree with people that there's a lack of money, and Bernard Schwartz is absolutely right. As a proportion of GDP, US infrastructure spending is lower than the OECD average, but I don't think it's just about a lack of money. I think it's about how that money is spent. So to take one very good example, the Highway Trust Fund, and the $50 billion or so that sluices out of Washington to the states every year, assuming it works, that money goes overwhelmingly, more than half of it, on new roads and on new interchanges or expanded interchanges, on new projects, not on maintenance of the other 99% of roads that are already built. There is a problem at state level with the incentives system there. And I think, you know, if you look at the Wisconsin Road Transportation Builders Association and their role in politics and their role in funding campaigns, that can be replicated across states around America. And that explains why so much of the money goes into new road projects that are not needed in an era where clearly peak car is over. Peak car is clearly over. You look at the usage rates, the mileage rates, they've been flat since 2000. We've had a tiny uptick in the last year because of a dramatic fall in gas prices, but only a tiny uptick. We're clearly past the point of peak car. A final point, because I know there's other people here, but I've got, you know, others I could bore you with. It's just picking up on Ram's that you cannot have.
Why don't you skip over the ones that will bore us and go to?
Okay. Well, this one might. I'll try and frame it sexily. But Ram talks about you can't have a 21st century economy with 20th century infrastructure. Absolutely right. I would just add to that: you cannot have 21st century infrastructure whilst we're stuck in this 20th century debate about it. And too much of the debate is focused on getting back to the funding levels of the Eisenhower era, rather than looking at the quality of the spending and the decision-making process for allocating the spending. And I think, you know, it's clearly a volume, a quantity of spending issue or of investment issue, but it's also a quality of investment issue. And I don't think that's anywhere near the Washington debate at the moment.
You know, I think these are all very useful points, and I just want to, you know, play a role here of sort of trying to pull this together as we move forward through the day. But, you know, one of the things we've done is we've defined the size of this issue, whether it's 1.7 or greater in terms of $1 trillion hole. But as Bernard says, there is some of that is being funded, and so the gap may be smaller, particularly if we look at it innovatively in an investment rather than in spending terms. As Senator Warner has talked about, different modalities of finding that financing are part of the solution, whether it's new authorities. Ram mentioned that we have some that we can use even better that we have been using. I think another set of questions are the problem becomes more manageable perhaps if we set our priorities in a different way and do it in a long-term context and frame this as a competitiveness issue. So the framing of it, the defining of the scope of it, the mechanisms for dealing with it, the framing of it, and examining the nature of the real urgent need that we've got are all critical steps towards moving towards a solution. Let me go to you, Damon, and I want to come back to you because I'd like to probe a little bit on the productivity issue in addition to whatever you want to say. All right, so go, yeah. Go ahead.
I wanted to respond to what David was saying about institutional investors.
You want to speak on the part of millennials also?
No. My children do that. But I would want to just reemphasize something Edward said about language here. The more that we use terms like infrastructure, and the more we have a public discourse that is about alphabet soup programs and so forth, the less effective this conversation is going to be. It's the combination of competitiveness and the promise of a genuinely better life that is the winning way to talk about this in large public discourse. And that's got to be tied to really a visionary understanding of what it is we're trying to do. But at the same time, and this is where David came in, and I want to really reinforce what he says from the perspective of the labor movement, which has been trying to get workers' capital to play a constructive role here, that it feeds back into what Ram was saying earlier. The two things David identified, the AFL-CIO has been working on trying to encourage pension funds to invest in infrastructure for about 5 years, very successful at getting them to commit money in principle, much more challenged when it comes to actually getting the money to projects. And the reasons are what David said. They are a misalignment in terms of the middlemen, essentially, and a lack of capacity in the plans. The solutions, though, right? Partly they could be in going at those things hammer and tongs, but in part they come back to what Governor Rendell was talking about earlier. Programs like the Build America bonds exist off the shelf that could, in large part, solve that problem. And the mayor's discussion about TIFIA similarly is an example of the kind of program that helps to solve those, that exists, that could solve those problems. The reason, and I'll just stop with this, the reason why Build America Bonds, why that is such a potentially valuable tool in terms of mobilizing pension capital, is because it's taxable. It's a taxable bond. And while in order to go and invest in a particular project at an equity level, there's a lot of politics you have to deal with, and you have to have somebody who can assess the business risks, to buy a federally issued taxable bond is something that a pension fund has a whole raft of people that do every day. We have the tools to begin to get at this at a granular level, but we don't have them deployed. And this comes back to the problems that Mark was so optimistic about earlier.
Yeah, it's true. And by the way, it's also true with regard to some new ideas, or you know, whether you call it an infrastructure bank or a financing authority, the mechanisms are in place to take the money, to leverage the money, to spend the money wisely. It's a fairly straight line from here to there as we want to expand these things. Let me go to Rob, and then I'll go to Bob.
We forget is that a lot of the transportation system is really about business use. It's about rail, it's about trucking. It's also about the carpenter that comes to your house to do some work, or the FedEx package that comes. And there's an amazing amount of inefficiency in that system that they have to pay for, not just with delay, but with uncertainty. I do want to, as much as I love and respect Ed Luce, I do want to push back a little bit on this, because I do think there's a sort of widespread view that this is really just about maintenance. One of my jobs that I had a while back was I was chair of the National Surface Transportation Infrastructure Finance Commission, which was a congressionally chartered commission to look at financing infrastructure. And we were quite conservative in our estimates. We were looking really kind of what do we need. And our argument, our analysis was that we were just to maintain what we have every year, not to expand it, just to make it so that it doesn't degrade in performance or quality. We're funding only 44% of what we need to fund. To get modest annual improvements, we're funding 36%. So I don't think there's any doubt. If you look, all of the studies that have been done on this, we simply are not, we're not even funding anything close to keeping the roads the way they should be, or transit. One interesting fact I think we looked at is, if you look at the share of income that people in the 60s and 70s spent to drive a mile, so how much of their income did they spend this year? To get to that level again, we would have to have $1 a gallon gas tax. So in other words, in the old days, people actually spent money on infrastructure and nobody complained about it. Today, the federal gas tax is 18.4 cents. It's lost about 40% of its value since 1994. So why don't we do this? And I think part of the problem is we can all talk about how good infrastructure is, but there is a fairly strong narrative on both sides of the aisle here that actually infrastructure investment is a bad thing. And I will take the risk of saying on the left, there's what I would call the congestion caucus, which wants congestion. Congestion for them is a way of getting their social policy goals achieved, which is for everybody to get out of their car and stop living in the suburbs. That's what they want. And I've had conversations with people who say, we don't want to raise the gas tax because that's going to go to expanding road capacity. We don't want people to drive. We want people to not drive. Making their commute miserable is a way to get there. And so not only that, but they actually use statistics, which are fundamentally wrong. All the studies have shown this, which they call the fallacy of induced demand. In other words, if you build more roads, you can't solve the problem. So if you have a view that's widely held by a big share of Washington, that expanding roads cannot improve congestion, why would you want to increase the gas tax? Even though the evidence is clear, expanding roads does reduce congestion. And on the other side, you have, I don't want to say the Freedom Caucus, even though there's a real Freedom Caucus, but there's a Freedom Caucus which wants to be free from taxes and wants to be free from the federal government. And it says things like the bridge to nowhere. And so we all have in our mind the terrible bridge to nowhere. Well, if you look at the peak period when we were doing congressional earmarks on transportation, they were about 4% of the transportation budget. They were a very, very small percent of the transportation budget. And almost all of those earmarks were actually really good projects. So I think there's what we've got to really do is get a new dialogue that this stuff works, it's not inefficient, the federal government plays a key role, and we can solve the problem. And I think that's part of the problem is neither side wants to, at least parts of neither side not want to acknowledge that.
Okay, we've got about 7 minutes left in this section. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to Bob Hormats, and then I'm going to Rosabeth, and then I'm going to go to Heidi to try and pull it all together, if she possibly can. Even if she can't, I'm going to go to her, however, to do that. And then we'll move on into the second phase of this thing, which is going to go and drill down into more specific kinds of solutions. But I'd ask each of you to keep it to 2 minutes. Okay, Bob.
I have more time to speak on the second session. I just wanted to make one point that follows up a point that Mark Warner made a moment ago. And it goes, in a way, back to the history that Carl mentioned. That is, if you take a look at who the advocates of infrastructure were, many of them were Republicans. Lincoln was a huge advocate of infrastructure, the Union Pacific Railway, many other things. They called them domestic improvements in those days. And the governor of New York, who did the Erie Canal, was, by the way, named Clinton. I think it's worth remembering this in the current debate.
Hold the mic closer to your mouth.
Okay, second, but that's a bit of the history. The point I wanted to make is this. It is, in the way the United States has addressed this in the past, you have to make certain short-term sacrifices for the long-term benefit of the system, of the economy, of living standards, which means you have to give up a certain amount today for a better life, better infrastructure, all these things tomorrow, because they don't pay off the day after the money is spent. And I think that's where Bernard's point about an investment budget is concerned. It's not just that it is a budget constructed to deal with investment, which Bernard's exactly right on. It's this intergenerational thing that the current generation has to utilize taxes, has to utilize other resources in order to build something for the future. And Bernard's absolutely right. The notion of an infrastructure bank or the notion of some kind of investment for the future, an investment budget, is part of creating the notion in people's minds that you make commitments today that enable the economy to prosper and be more productive and be more competitive tomorrow. That mindset, it seems to me, is what we're missing here. And that needs to be built into the way we structure the funding and the way we present it to people. This generation, as the greatest generation, did certain things, not just to benefit them, but for longer term benefits. That has to be part of the political debate. It isn't.
Okay. Rosabeth, briefly.
So first of all, as one who tried to make infrastructure sexy with John Stewart.
And now he's off the air.
But I got in there early. The idea of how we talk about it first, I think, is very important. We do need a new national narrative. Most of those big projects, in fact, most of our big investments came under the national defense aegis. That's how we've done big projects. What substitutes for that now? What kind of thinking? It is about building the future. It is about mobility. It is about some vision for the country. As for the millennials, whom I teach, and many of them are my best friends, it's interesting that we may be counting on, we're talking about millennials, counting on millennials for long-term thinking. Well, there is so much short-term gratification. In fact, all of the new business models that were mentioned, whether it's Uber or Airbnb, are all about doing things instantaneously through technology. So we have a challenge here, aside from talking about many modes of transportation in the same breath, which we often don't. We also need to connect long-term to short-term pain. And we are not going to get traction for long-term visions, which are incredibly important, unless we're also connecting them to some tangible short-term outcome that helps with people's pain. We are paying enormous costs already, the lost productivity because of just extra traffic congestion has been estimated to be about $121 billion a year in wasted time and fuel. If we had a way to capitalize on the saved costs of the current problems, we would also have something like social impact bonds. We would also have a way to find new sources of financing. The idea here is we need flexibility, we need to look at things holistically, and we need to combine things that look like polar opposites.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, one of the things that we're trying to do here, as I said, is we're trying to produce productive suggestions about how to move forward. And one of the ways we're going to do that is that we are going to take the findings of this discussion and turn it into a kind of a white paper, and we are going to distribute that widely. But part of the way we're going to do this is constantly at the end of each round of this thing come back and say, what is the takeaway? You know, what are the action items that the country needs to address, or what are the ways we need to reframe the debate? And so at the end of each session, we've got somebody that we've sort of teed up to try to tie things together and to tick off what the big takeaways for that session are before we move on to the next session. And that, by the way, is the way that we're going to go here. We'll do this, we'll wrap it up. We then got the next session, which is we really want to talk among all of you about specific solutions, specific things that you think will take us forward, whether it's an infrastructure bank or it's expanding a program like TIFI or something else. What can we do? Then after that, Senator Elizabeth Warren is going to speak. Then after that, the Vice President is going to speak. Then after that, best of all, perhaps we'll have a half an hour for lunch, and everybody will get some food, and then we're going to get everybody together, and then we're going to really try to draw some conclusions about how do you actually get this done? How do you do it in the political environment that we're in now and that we're likely to be in? So I just want you to know that. The other thing I want to say, and I'm going to say this again at the end of the next session, is that because of the security associated with the vice president, once we get to the point of Senator Warren coming in here, if you leave, you may not actually be able to get back in. So I'd advise you guys to stick around. And one of the ways that we will induce that is by having people like Heidi sum these things up. So let me turn to you, Heidi.
Thank you.
You're going to be brave. Let's try it.
I'm going to give it a shot. No? All right. So I'm going to start with the infrastructure needs to be sexy and take it from there, because I think if you haven't seen the John Oliver segment, you really should. He does a really good job of starting off by blowing up infrastructure across the board and saying it's the bridges in the movies that we blow up. This is what we're talking about.
I personally find the static a little bit annoying, so sorry. Go ahead.
So I would recommend that you take a look, and it's also a good way to appeal to a different audience and really figure out a way to capture the public imagination around infrastructure, because it is partially a marketing issue. It is when I told my daughter I was speaking at another infrastructure panel, she said, again? Things like the Chamber of Commerce just came out yesterday with an emoji-based description, a pitch of what's wrong in infrastructure and what are some of the proposals on the table to look at this. I'm gonna run that by my daughter, but things that actually reach out to a different generation and get them thinking in different ways and maybe not fixated on the actual term infrastructure, but on what it means in terms of the ability to move people, goods, information, energy, everything that defines infrastructure that makes for the productivity is really what we're getting at here. Going back to Bernard's original point that we need to actually look at this as investment and not as spending, and how do we do that? Senator Warner poured a little bit of cold water on the ability of Congress to come up with a new approach in Congress to how we score and budget for things like infrastructure investment. But that needs to be a change in public narrative, and I think you hit the nail on the head by starting with that. And the second issue that you mentioned around jobs, we do have the data, not just from the governor, but we have from S&P has run the numbers, you have a Department of Labor has run the numbers. You actually get a much bigger boost in jobs than you would anticipate in terms of what per billion spent and per job that you get on the back of that. So Senator Warner had a very long list that looked at our inability to raise taxes. I think anyone looking at the highway trust fund, you just go straight to that gas tax model and know that it's broken. And if we can't raise it, link it to inflation or do something in order to adjust that or come up with a new funding model, then we're never really going to get to a long-term solution and away from Band-Aids on highway trust fund. In terms of looking at the infrastructure bank, the Bridge Act, which used to be the Build Act, I'm particularly partial to, and it's Senator Warner's not here anymore, but it essentially takes what is TIFIA and makes it multi-sector. It takes the terms and conditions that TIFIA has and basically depoliticizes it. It gives it a board that has relevant expertise that are not political. It has a credit focus. It's really meant to take TIFIA and make it multi-sector. So I would encourage you all to take a look at that particular. I'm glad he changed the name from bank because that was horrible. And it'll do the trick, I'm sure. But it's not the silver bullet, but it is one potential tool in the toolbox that Mayor Rahm Emanuel mentioned. You need to have lots of tools in the toolbox. That's one that we don't have, and literally every other country in the world has one. In terms of productivity, I think I touched briefly on that. It's a running theme that we don't think enough about, but businesses certainly do. And when you have an inability of cars to get to work, if you have an inability of rapid transit to be rapid, you have a problem. People don't get where they need to be. Information doesn't get where it needs to be, and products don't get where they need to be. So the productivity issue is one that I think has a big has a lot of potential when you're talking with businesses. When you're talking with consumers and individuals, you can talk about the fact that they have to pay a lot for car repair when they go over the potholes. So, I mean, there are costs that are associated as well with congestion and fuel and repair that go straight to consumers. On the very good comments from our token millennial, how do you pay for it? The flip side is how do you come up with innovative finance? And a lot of the answers are tucked away within the long-term investor base, the pension funds, the endowments. BABS is a very good idea. To bring it back would be should be a no-brainer. And not only does it unlock pension funds that are not able to invest in tax-free municipal bonds right now, it opens it up to an international investor base because they won't buy tax-free bonds. They don't have any incentive. So it's one of those, it should be a no-brainer, but we can't seem to get there. So off-the-table solutions, BABS, TIFIA, they exist. They could be grown into national infrastructure financing authorities. And I think to the extent that we here can take this initial conversation and move it to real practical solutions in the second panel, I think will help make not only an informed public here, but also hopefully make it a little bit more sexy.
Excellent. That's exactly how we want to tee it up to the next part.